Right now, I'm a public speaker, and I also teach part-time at a community college. I teach five classes every quarter, four English composition and one philosophy. But when I'm not doing that, I'm on the road speaking. Believe it or not, you're looking at somebody that used to be famous. I spent 4 years as a young man soon after I graduated from Ohio University. I spent 4 years walking around the world, solo, by myself with a backpack, and of course a notepad and a pen. We didn't have cell phones and laptops back then. This was in the 1980s. And I wrote several hundred stories and three books, and was on, you know, almost all the talk shows at one point. I set out from my hometown is Southern Ohio, and spent 4 years walking across five of the continents, North America, Europe, Africa, Asia, and Australia. And during that time, I never knew what each day was going to bring. Nothing was planned. I wanted every day to be a total surprise because I knew that would make the best stories. And I stayed with hundreds of families, and they became the basis of many of my stories that were read back here in America by over, about 1.5 million families. So my journey around the world became quite popular with a lot of Americans. And I ended up putting those into some books, which used to be everywhere, but they're now out of print. And it was a great adventure. I was even in the Guinness Book of Records for being the first man to walk around the world solo. So that was kind of cool. After I walked around the world, I thought, well, I'll probably do a couple speeches to some Lion Clubs or Rotary Clubs or something, and then go back to work as a journalist, which was what I was doing before I walked around the world. I was a newspaper journalist and also a magazine writer. But then it turned out that the walk around the world became, it took on a life of its own, let's put it that way. And right after I came home, there were about six or seven publishers that were vying for the book. I've selected one, William Morrow, out of New York there, and they published a book of my journey, and it became very popular. And that, with all of the talk shows I did, led to a lot of people asking me to come and speak to their colleges or companies or schools or whatever. So what happened was, I never got to go back to work as a journalist. For the next 25 years, is it? A little more than that, maybe. I would stay busy as a speaker and an author just things related to that. But lately, I've been wanting to cut down on the travel and to be home more. And so what I've been steering myself towards now is using some of those experiences and wisdoms that I gained from walking around the world into teaching, and to sharing those with young people and inspiring them to think differently out of the box and to not be afraid of life, to take risks and to be creative and to realize that there's a million stories out there that are just begging to be told and written down. And so I now spend a good chunk of the year teaching English and philosophy at the local community college by where I live. I don't think that I was formally involved in any of the journalistic organizations. I was always a maverick. I was never one who belonged to anything. I was the weird kid who, turned in the weird papers, wrote about weird subjects, was always out there off on his own, seeking out a different kind of story. I never was comfortable in anything that was organized or planned or formal. Never was. In fact, to show you how I was, I can remember, for example, winning a big award here from Ohio University, the Medal of Merit, which is one of their top honors for anybody that's gone here. I remember showing up in, like, at first in blue jeans and a t-shirt. But my wife brought along a suit and tie, you know, unbeknownst to me, and made me put it on before I went, you know, to the banquet and everything. I've always been, you know, the loner and the maverick, but I've loved it. It's been a good life for me. It's the way I wanted to be. Know how to write. I teach so many students now each year in English composition classes, and I'm shocked at how many of them don't know their grammar, their sentence structure, how to do a proper paragraph, how to organize a story or an essay. There is so much poor writing out there right now. And if you will focus on your writing skills and on your English especially, your creativity, you'll stand out from so many of the other journalist graduates, from so many of the other would-be writers. Those who are going into writing, of course, is what I'm talking about, is who I'm talking to. So one of my most biggest pieces of advice is buckle down and learn the grammar and the little things. Make your writing stand out from everyone else's. Make it flawless as you can. And my second bit of advice is to, again, be creative. Seek to find the unique story or be a unique person yourself. I can remember when I was at Ohio University, I won a national magazine writing competition that was sponsored by Reader's Digest. And I had to fly to New York and meet all these famous people and stuff. And I remember one of the editors coming up to me and saying to me, "Steve, there's a million people who would love to be a writer, but we would give $1 million if we could find one who had a unique idea." Uniqueness counts for so much in this cluttered and crowded media fields that we have anymore. You need to try to some way find a niche to stand out. It's hard to do. It's very hard to do because it seems like there aren't any new ideas anymore. But keep in mind that after he talked to me at that awards conference there in New York, it was soon after that I decided to do something that no one had ever done before. And that was to take a solo walk around the world and see the world from the dirt up and write about it. And you know, make it all spontaneous. And I think that's one reason why I had so many people who wanted to do the book and why I was able to live off of it. Still am, 30 years later. Still living off of what everybody said was a crazy, wacky idea. And, everybody told me just stay what you're doing. Stay in the newspaper office and don't stir up any trouble and don't stand out. You know, you're on your way to the top. I had won some writing awards and was very diligent and hard worker and had dug up lots of great stories that were selling lots of papers. But it wasn't exciting enough and unique for me. I wanted to do something that no other journalist had done. And again, that was to go out there and meet the people of the world face to face with just a backpack and a good pair of hiking boots on and get into their homes and meet them personally for several years. For what it's worth, it's been a great life. I can't say anything. And of course, part of that magic of my life was going to OU, was going to Ohio University and the School of Journalism here. I wouldn't be who I am today if I hadn't have gone to this school. Because at this school, I was forced, made by people like Drew, for instance, to buckle down and to get my grammar and my writing the correct way and get organized. Because I told you, I was a wild maverick. It took people like that to really tame me. Because they did, I was able to focus and to take my writing skills and do something worthy with it.